I know it seems very new to people, this whole wave of cryptocurrencies, and I actually have a theory that it's nothing new. It's actually a kind of a visit to the past. And if you think about human history, humans have been civilized for maybe 100,000 years. You know, they've been around in some form of primate or whatever for, you know, a couple million years. But over that entire period of time, there have always been multiple currencies until just recently. So if you think about what life was like when you were a, you know, in the beginning of civilization, work was really more inspiration-based. You would basically do what you wanted to do whenever you needed to do it during the day, and you were flexible with who you worked with. So you might pick four friends to go pick berries with in the morning and six other ones to go fish with in the afternoon, but you did a variety of jobs throughout the day. It wasn't until the Industrial Revolution, so really only like 150 years of the hundreds of thousands or possibly millions of human organization, it's only been the Industrial Revolution where the productivity model changed and where people that controlled capital could control capital assets, and people were sort of stripped down to hamsters running on wheels performing single functions like a worker on the Henry Ford assembly line. And it's only been in that period that currency looks the way it does today, which is abnormal. So if you think about the US dollar, for example, it's only been in place since 1944. I mean, there was a US dollar in the revolutionary era, but in that period, even in the 1800s, there were over 200 different currencies circulating inside the United States, even with the US dollar in existence. And it wasn't until the real peak of the Industrial Revolution, right at the end of World War II, the US government called together all the leaders of the European countries after World War II, and they created Bretton Woods, where they basically declared the dollar would be on the gold standard, and every dollar or $35 would purchase an ounce of gold. So the scenario at the time, you basically had World War II end. You had maybe 100 million people milling about in Europe with literally nothing because everything had been destroyed. So economies had to be created. And at that point in time, Bretton Woods was called. The US basically had the leaders of the other nations come to Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, and they just made an edict to give everyone confidence that there would be $35 per ounce of gold. And individuals knew they could take their dollar, walk up to the Federal Reserve window and actually turn it in and get a little bit of gold. So that created a frame of reference. And every other currency in Europe was basically abstracted off the dollar. So there was a declaration that, you know, the lira, a certain number of lira would be, you know, X lira to the dollar, a certain number of francs to the dollar, a certain number of marks to the dollar, British pounds to the dollar. So there was sort of a tree of value coming from one central thing that people trusted that was gold. That actually only lasted 28 years. So the in 1972, the French government had accumulated a lot of dollars, and they literally took the dollars to Fort Knox, to the Federal Reserve window, and asked for their gold. And President Nixon realized that if he let France do it, everybody would do it, and they didn't have enough to go around. You know, because what had happened was basically because of the economic productivity of the nations using currencies, they had stored up dollar bills. That was basically the key to having an economy. And once the gold standard broke, we moved forward into another era, you know, known as petro-dollar. Because of the forcing of the countries in the Middle East to accept dollars as payment for barrels of oil, now you had a way to essentially guarantee your economic future as a nation by piling up dollars in your foreign reserve. And by doing so, you were essentially storing oil, which was the root of productivity in the age of the Industrial Revolution and an oil-based economy. So what's happened now is we basically move forward to a period of time where oil is still relevant, but electricity is more relevant. You know, if I basically gave you a choice 24 hours from now to cut off your access to oil or electricity, you would choose to keep electricity. The root of all your productivity today is not burning oil. It's what you do with the electrons in your computers, your smartphones, your daily life with light. And so I think what's happened is the backing of currency has moved from a fixed asset like gold to something that you could turn into economic productivity in the form of oil. And it's already moved to electricity, but we just don't know it. You know, so I think you hear this term, the fourth industrial revolution. Electrons are effectively the backing of currency in the fourth industrial revolution, and we're already there. So I think what you see in these ICOs is they're basically encapsulations of electrons that perform a certain function, and they're communities of interest that form around each set of those that believe a certain thing. You know, you can look at the nation state too. I think with the industrial revolution and military power, the nation state as we know it, that's also only existed for a few hundred years, and the shape of the nation state today is one that is there to protect the economic assets from the Industrial Revolution. As we go forward now, people are basically digital citizens where everybody's a little molecule in a distributed fabric, and people can join or not multiple communities of interest that are beyond physical borders. So what you see is groupings of people that believe in certain things. They have the same belief system, same culture, same whatever it is that they are interested in. And those have become virtual nations, virtual economies that are willing to trade amongst themselves. I mean, a dollar is really just a token of value exchange, as were pebbles and shells and the stones of YAP and credit default swaps. So it's, you know, what you believe in. And so I think we're now in a period where there are multiple currencies, just like there have been for 99.99% of human history.